Santiago was 11 years old. He was in jail. The trouble had been brewing for a long time. Santiago fought with his teachers and argued fiercely with his father. He kept getting kicked out of school, but he didn't mind. He hated school. Santiago's memory was bad. This made it even harder for him to learn. Math was something he especially hated. He wanted to be an artist, but his father thought art was useless. Santiago was headed for failure. It's hard to believe what actually happened. Santiago won the Nobel Prize. That's like an Olympic gold medal for science. He is now called the father of modern neuroscience. That is, the science of how the brain works. I'm going to tell you about how it happened. But to understand Santiago's story, we first need to learn a little more about the brain. Over to you, Barb.
Your brain has a lot of tiny neurons in it. But even though they're tiny, neurons are the building blocks of our brain. To help you understand neurons, let's think of them as tiny aliens from outer space. Here's the eye of the neuron alien. Here's the arm. And its three legs are down here. Terry, how does this compare with a real neuron?
Well, here's something more like a real neuron. Here's the neuron's legs. They're called dendrites. And here's the neuron's arm. It's called an axon. The eye in the main body of the neuron is called the nucleus. Real neurons have more than three legs, many more. Neurons come in all sorts of shapes and sizes. Look at those little knobs. They're called dendritic spines. You can think of them as being like toes that are scattered all over the space alien's legs. Kind of creepy. But hey, if neurons didn't have so many toes, they wouldn't be able to get their job done. Dendritic spines may be small, but they are really important. The spines help neurons receive signals from other neurons.
You can understand this by remembering our space aliens. When a neuron alien wants to talk to the next alien, its arm gives a tiny shock to the toe of the next alien. Neuron aliens show friendship by giving tiny shocks to one another. Just one of those strange things.
But it's surprisingly similar for real neurons. An axon ripples a signal along its arm called a spike. When the spike gets to the end of the arm, it causes a chemical to jump across a special narrow gap that activates the dendritic spine of the next neuron. This is called a synapse. If that second neuron fires a spike, it can cause a chain of spikes in the whole set of neurons, and it just keeps going. These signals flowing between neurons are carrying your thoughts. You can think of them as being like trails on your mental pinball machine. By the way, this is the only place where neurons are close enough so that they can actually cross, signals can cross from one neuron to the next. And there are a lot of synapses in your brain, a million billion synapses. If I had a dollar for every synapse in your brain, I would be a billionaire a million times over.
Great. You now understand how a neuron passes along a signal and how you think. Well, maybe it's more complicated. There's some chemistry involved, but you've got the basics.
Yes. What's really interesting here, the more often a neuron shocks the next neuron, the stronger the synaptic connection becomes between them. It's like friends who become better friends because they talk a lot. Real neurons are like that too. Neuroscientists have a saying. Neurons that fire together wire together. Wiring together means that a brain link is being created. Learning means creating a stronger brain link.
When you're first beginning to learn something, the brain links are weak. There may only be a few neurons linked together, and the spark between the neurons isn't very big. As you practice a new idea, the synaptic links get stronger. This means the sparks get bigger. You can get more neurons with stronger synapses. The brain links get bigger and better. More complicated ideas can make longer brain links. People sometimes think of brain links as if they were mouse paths in a forest. The more the mouse runs along the path, the wider the path gets. The easier it is to follow the path. The fact that paths in your brain change and grow is called neuroplasticity. This fancy word just means your neurons can change. That's why you can change.
Now, back to Santiago Ramon y Cajal. Let's find out how he was able to change from bad boy to superstar.
I'm Barb Oakley.
I'm Greg Hammonds.
And I'm Terry Sinofsky.
We and Arizona State University wish you happy learning.